Good morning. I pray that this morning you have come with the purpose to worship.
Amen.
Worship. What is worship? The shepherds came and they knelt before the newborn babe in his presence simply just to worship him. The wise men traveled from hundreds of miles, the rough and unbearable terrain, just so that they could worship their newborn king. We read in Revelation 7:11 that the angels and the elders fell on their face before the throne to worship God. If the common shepherds and the learned wise men, and if the heavenly beings can fall down and worship, then friend, are too we not called to worship? Worship has been defined as the feeling or the expression of reverence and adoration to God. It means to literally bow down to God. Worship is an act of love by mortals, being made manifested toward a holy and just God. Can I say this? Worship was never intended for man. Worship is for God. It has been described as man's ministry to God, for God's pleasure, for God's heart, for God's opinion, for God's taste, and for God's desires. Worship was not for our entertainment, but it belongs all to God.
Right.
This morning, as we enter into the service, we enter in with a choice to worship God or not. We enter with a choice to express our love or not. The psalmist said, "You are my God. I will exalt you and praise your name." I invite you to stand with me this morning as Brother Seth comes and leads us in singing. Let us enter into this service with our hearts lifted up, voices ready to sing and praise the Lord. Let us worship him with hearts of love and adoration.
Our shelter from the storm. thankful, Lord, that we know that you are our guide as we step into the unknown of an untried year. Lord, we do not know what's going to happen this year, but we do know with confidence that you will be with us, that you will go before us, that you will protect us, that you will provide for us. And we are so grateful for that today. And we can with confidence step forward, knowing that you have gone before us wherever we might go. Lord, we're grateful that we're in your presence today, that you are here with us, that you deigned to come down to live among us, to live in our very own hearts, and to make us your temple. We're thankful for that. We're thankful, Lord, that we know that when we give our lives and our hearts to you, that when you are in control, that everything is right, and that no matter what we face, you will be with us. Thank you for that, Lord Jesus. We give you praise this morning, and we worship you and honor you, the God of the ages, the God of the past, of the present, and of the future. And we worship you with grateful hearts this morning. In Jesus' mighty and matchless name, we offer praise. Amen. You may be seated.
Jesus will still be. I'm proud of our young people.
Amen.
And that includes Mrs. Emery as well. Oh, wonderful, wonderful. Well, I invite your attention to Matthew's gospel. And Matthew chapter 2, we'll spend our time there this morning. And I just want to read the first two verses. I'll expand beyond the first two verses as we continue, but I just wanted to focus on these two. As you're turning there, we will actually this evening, Cameron Sankey will be coming and will be joining us for the next 6 weeks for his internship. So you'll see him. You'll see him on the platform. You'll see him around the school and in our groups and various ministries. So we look forward to him joining us for the next 6 weeks also. And then a week from Tuesday, our Guatemala group will be heading out to Guatemala for how many days? 10 days? 8 days? 8 days doing some medical missions there and some preaching as well. So I'm not joining them this year. I enjoyed being there last year. I would enjoy being there this year, but things just didn't work out for me to be able to go. But we want to be praying for them as well, as Pastor Davis and Pastor Garcia lead that group, and that God would bless their efforts. Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 and 2 says, "Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, 'Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him.'" Let's bow our heads for a moment of prayer. Father, we ask your blessing upon the reading of your word. Would our thoughts, our mind, our heart all be engaged with your spirit as you speak to us through your word? And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, how would you feel if you were the king or the queen and some well-dressed dignitaries from faraway land came to your palace, knocked on your door, came into your office or whatever special room you have, knowing well that you are the king of this land or you are the queen of this land, and with straight faces and earnest spirits asked you point blank, "Where's the king?" Well, you might be insulted, you might be offended, you might be appalled, you might be angered. A lot of emotions at that point may rise up within you. Don't they really understand who I am? I am the king. I am the queen. I am the head of this state. What other person are they looking for? Now, it's not that Rome doesn't matter to these travelers. It's not that they don't care about the imperial authority. They undoubtedly recognize that Herod is a king because they went to Herod. They paid their respect. But in reality, Herod's house or his palace or his court, wherever it was that they met him, it was merely a hallway to the one that they were really seeking. Or perhaps, maybe more than a hallway, really it was perhaps an obstacle. It was just a necessary detour. It was more an inconvenience on their quest to find the king. And yet here we see the king, Herod, is rather a necessary inconvenience for them, for the king that they're trying to find. So imagine it would be a little bit like us going to Washington, D.C. and approaching the Oval Office, and it doesn't matter who the president would be, but going to the president, making all the preparations for making an appearance in the nation's capital, standing before what many people say is the most powerful person on earth, and paying respects, giving honor, you know, wearing our best suit or whatever it is that we have, and going through all of the security and everything, all the pomp and circumstance that would be required for having an audience with the president. And it comes down after perhaps some small talk that the president says, "Okay, well, so what's this meeting for? You've scheduled this meeting with me. What's it for?" And you were to reply, and you'd say, "Well, I'm really looking for somebody. Can you tell me where to find them?" Can you tell me, I've heard that he's in some little known hole in the wall here in the city, and can you tell me where to find him? What, don't you think that our president, perhaps especially our current president, might be especially offended that you're not there for him? Anyone perhaps would who held that position of power. Except it's not directions to a hole-in-the-wall place that gets the king's attention, but really it's what follows. To add salt to an already wounded ego, these dignitaries, we call them wise men, magi they're called, these dignitaries, they ask the question, they're not just asking directions, but they're asking particularly this question, where is the king? Where is the king? We've been talking about Jesus, our Emmanuel, which means God with us. God is with us. That means the king is with us. But here on this occasion, the seekers are asking, but where is the king? Whatever Herod was, he was not an undercover boss. Everyone knew that he is in charge. There was no disguise, no effort to keep a secret of his true identity, no modesty in his personal air. He is well known as a very self-centered, extravagant, immodest person. And as abominable as the musical, it's many years old now, Jesus Christ Superstar is, it captures the arrogance and the pomp of Herod. He was not a modest leader. When I was in Israel and after I was in Israel, I had the privilege of studying and even there discussing with other theologians different portrayals of Jesus there in the Holy Land. One of those being this Jesus Christ Superstar, which is, what was that, 80s? Was that 80s, 70? I don't know. I don't recommend it, but it's a fascinating to see a modern portrayal, a very cultural portrayal of Jesus, a mockery of Jesus, a mockery of Herod also. But when we think it can't get worse, it does. The Magi not only offended him by coming and looking for a different king, but they added these words, "We're looking for the king because we've come to worship him." Now, this is more than even Herod could wish for, because people don't come to Herod to worship him. Worship is the prerogative of Caesar. Caesar has people. He pays people to come and worship him. He has choirs that come and sing his praises. So even Herod, this king in this Roman province, he can't even hope for someone to come and worship him. But these men are even looking for him as king. They're looking for a different king to worship. These men have no interest in Caesar. These men have no interest in his gods. But here in Herod, we find a man who is easily insulted. By all accounts, his fury and his rage from this insult, this personal affront, it ends up costing dozens of mothers the lives of their sons. Herod was insanely insecure. We find that so clear in Matthew chapter 2. Let's look at the question behind the question that these magi asked. They asked the question, where is he? Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? Now, we've been exploring, as I mentioned, this idea of Jesus, our Emmanuel, and asking the question on several occasions, where is Jesus? If he is with us, then where is he? Where do we find him? From the brickyards of Egypt. Go back to the Old Testament. From the brickyards of Egypt, now to the courts of the king. These words, where is he, have come from the mouths of slaves and nobles. This fact alone reminds us that every human being across the spectrum, the social, economic spectrum, shares in common a quest to find the one who gives us, gives humanity its meaning. The one who breaks in among us and makes sense of it all. Where is he? Where is he, they ask. But that's not merely a question of searching for a child. It's a question of expectation. When the wise men pose this inquiry to King Herod, they explain, where is he who has been born king of the Jews? You see, this question, where is he, has already been preceded by a previous question, who is he? But they already know the answer to that. And they bring the answer to Herod. They know who it is they're seeking. They just need to know where he is.
Right.
Well, this isn't the question for which the Magi were seeking an answer. Who is he? They already knew that. That question was settled. It was settled before. It was settled a long time ago when they were already packed up, ready to go when the sign would come. It was already decided before they made the long journey from the east across that wilderness and over the mountains and into this foreign land. It was already decided long ago. They knew the answer of who it is that they were seeking. They just didn't know exactly where. They didn't know precisely where to find him. Their confidence was high. They knew that they would find him. They knew that the promised Messiah had come. They had recognized the sign of the star, and they had followed it all the way. Now, this is interesting. I think God did this on purpose. They followed the star until it led them to Herod's house. And although they knew the question of who they were seeking, God wanted them to pose a different question to Herod. Where is the king? So I don't know if God was up there laughing or not. I don't know. But God has a way of just, perhaps not laughing, but he has a way of just of working in irony so that this man who was so very self-centered, and by the way, would not have been entirely ignorant of the Jewish expectation of a promised king. But that wasn't on his mind. He was king. He had all the power of Rome behind him. He knew that if someone else tried to take his place, to usurp him, that he would have, with just a spoken word, the authority to do what he did, and that is to kill many people in order to preserve his position. But this is interesting. These are not shepherds, all right? The shepherds have found Jesus. They worshiped him. Jesus is actually a little bit older now. These are not shepherds. These are dignitaries. These are people with wealth. These are people who are on the other end of the social spectrum from the shepherds. These are men who you would expect would bring gold, frankincense, and myrrh to Herod, but they didn't. In fact, I wondered, as I've read this, did Herod see the gold and frankincense and myrrh? Did he see this entourage, and did he think, oh, wow, well, how privileged I am to have such a reputation that these men from so far away in the east would come and see me and bring these wonderful gifts. See how great I am? Until they ask, where is the king? Well, I'm not the true king. We know who you are here. We're looking for the king. And on top of that, the king of the Jews. The king of the Jews. And so Herod, he assembles his chief priests and his scholars to find out where is this Christ to be king. Did you notice here, the wise men, their question is, where is he who's been born king of the Jews? His question to the scholars is, where is the Messiah, the Christ?
Right.
Christ, the promised one. That tells me he knew something about the promise. He knew something about the expectation.
Right.
He knew something about those people that he was king over, that they were expecting a day to come when someone would perhaps usurp him in some way. That was his thought, his idea. Now the wise men knew that Jesus was present. They saw his sign, the star, as far away as wherever they were from, that far country. It only remained for them to seek him out, to follow the star, to go wherever it would lead them. And it led them, and apparently paused long enough for them to spend this short time with Herod. And so Herod poses this question to his scholars, to the Jewish scholars, and he says, where is this Christ to be born? And so they knew, of course, the Old Testament says, the prophets say that he would be born in this little town of Bethlehem. Well, it seems that Herod reciprocated the same question. He was asked, where is the king? And he passed that question on, where is the Christ? They were two very different questions. Both sought to know where Jesus was, right? The Magi made a great journey to find Jesus. Herod didn't go anywhere, but he called people to him, where is Jesus? Herod asked the question because he intended to kill Jesus. The Magi asked the question because they intended to worship him. You see, there can be no neutral response when God breaks in among us. There is no neutrality. When we moved into our house where we live now in 2014, the house was considered uninhabitable by the bank because several things, walls had been taken out and floors were taken out and plumbing, electrical. So we had to do some work to even get a loan on the bank for the house. And Reed Cooper spent some time over there. My father-in-law, you should have seen them. Reed and my father-in-law were going over there working on some of the electrical work. You remember that? And I remember, I'm not an electrician, so I may get details wrong, but if I recall correctly, there was a wire that should have been a neutral, I believe. Shouldn't have been shocking people, right? But it was. In fact, I don't know if this is even possible. You have to tell me, Reed. But my memory tells me that even after we had shut off all the breakers, there still seemed to be a current going through this. So things were haywire, and they were trying to sort all of that out, and did get sorted out, I think, as far as I know. We haven't had any fires, so which I'm thankful for. But here is an occasion where something was supposed to be neutral, right? It was supposed to be neutral, but it wasn't. As I thought about this idea of this question that was repeated here, where is Jesus? It's when Jesus comes, there is no neutrality.
Right.
Amen. We can be as you know, sorry if anyone's Swiss here, but we can be as Swiss as we think we can be. You know, Switzerland is known for neutrality. They're always neutral in world wars. They were neutral, right? They were the neutral people. You can be as Swiss as you want to be, but neutrality breaks down when your enemy or when your best friend is on your doorstep knocking on your door, right? Because in that occasion, indifference, yeah, it's my best friend, I'm just going to ignore him. That's not neutral. Right. You understand? When your enemy is knocking on your door and you think, I'm just going to ignore him, that kind of indifference is not neutrality. As we read the Gospels of the New Testament, we find that there is belief and there is unbelief. There's no neutrality. Ignoring Jesus is unbelief.
Right.
Being indifferent toward Jesus is unbelief. Being uncommitted to Jesus is unbelief, is denial of the Christ.
Amen.
One cannot witness the death and the burial of Jesus and then 3 days later walk up to an empty tomb and then walk away and have only on your mind, I wonder what I'm going to eat today. There's no neutrality to an empty tomb.
That's right. Amen.
There's no contented mediocrity in the muddled middle. To be told that you're the heir of a kingdom doesn't allow for neutrality. There's no gray area. There's no neutral zone. This isn't like capture the flag where you have this kind of safe, you can just, it doesn't matter what team you're on. You either accept it or you reject it. Indifference or just forgetting about it, that's rejection. Just as, your creditors would think that as well. God confronts us in Jesus. He contradicts us. He bothers us. He bugs us until we understand the truth about ourselves and about him. Now, Herod was not indifferent. No, he was not indifferent. The Magi were not indifferent. They both represent dedication. They both represent a commitment to very different ideas. One dedicated, committed to destroying Jesus. The other committed to exalting him. And those are really our own two options. That's
right.
It. That's it. We will either try to get rid of Jesus or we will exalt him.
Right.
And in the end, Paul tells us in Philippians chapter 2, he says, in the end, at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow. There's no neutrality in that at all. Every knee will bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father.
Amen.
That's a fact. There's nothing neutral in that. And for some people, they're going to get the shock of their life. in those moments, where they realize that you cannot just discard or be indifferent toward Jesus. He confronts us. God confronts us in Jesus Christ. If there's anything that would make unbelievers feel indifferent toward Jesus, I think it may be this. It would be seeing Christians who go to church, let's say, who go to church where Jesus has promised he would be found, right? But not worship him.
Right.
Probably nothing would make the world more indifferent toward Jesus than seeing a rather lethargic, unenthusiastic church.
Amen.
Thousands of people today are gathered in sanctuaries all around the world, many of them putting their lives at risk for the name of Christ, to gather with a two or three or four or half a dozen people to worship Christ. While others, perhaps millions, will gather and they really don't know why they're doing this. People go to church because, well, it's what culture says they're supposed to do on a Sunday morning. People go to church to enjoy good music. Well, that's a good reason to go to church. That's okay. Some people go to church to see their friends, to eat breakfast in some cases, to maybe even to hear an inspiring talk. Some go to because they want to know what programs are being offered, maybe for their children or for their young people. They want to know what the sports schedule is this week for the church leagues or whatever else. There are a lot of reasons why people go to church other than worship. And I'm not saying that any of those things are wrong in themselves. I've even heard, as a fact, I have heard people talk about going to a church because their manager went there and they hoped for a promotion. And so they started attending a church for the sake of just trying to get a social one-uppance on somebody else. This is what Herod said. Herod said he wanted to go to worship too, didn't he? Go and search diligently for the child. Put everything, the same effort that's gotten you here, keep putting that effort in. You go find him, all right? Go find him. And when you have found him, bring me back word so that I also can come and worship him. Well, he said the right thing.
Right.
Of course, he wasn't willing to put in the effort himself to go seek the Christ child, but he said he wanted to go worship the king. Now, you may not come to church to kill Jesus, all right? I don't think any of you have come for that reason. But there will be people today in church in many places, perhaps even here, with no greater pretense than what Herod had. No intent whatsoever to come and worship King Jesus.
Right.
But there is no equivocation in the Magi's purpose. They were clear. They made it clear. They had a single purpose, to find Jesus, to worship him, and to give him gifts. And the worship and the giving of gifts, that goes together, right? That's not two different actions. That's one action. Those gifts were tangible, material signs, symbols of their love and their appreciation and their recognition of who Jesus is. Then, as it is now, when dignitaries from one place will visit the head of a state, they'll bring gifts. They will honor their host with a gift from their country. And that's exactly what the Magi were doing. Their gifts were symbols of royalty and honor. They were implicitly acknowledging that Jesus is the head of this state. And again, I can't help but wonder if as they were coming or going, if Herod saw these gifts. And there's no indication that they brought any gifts to Herod. Now, all of this leads me to the conclusion that the only appropriate response to Jesus is worship.
That's right.
So what does worship look like in this passage? Well, let's look at this. I think there are three points in this passage that we can notice regarding worship. And the first is that worship seeks. Worship is an action of seeking.
That's right.
You see. Now, I know how it works. I've sat in those pews. I've sat in pews many places, and you, why now? This is really easy to do when you know you're away for Christmas holiday or some other time, and I always enjoy visiting a church whenever you know we're away from here, and we'll go in and I don't know, maybe you feel here the way I do other places. I go in, I think I'm just going to sit today and just watch. You ever feel that way? You get around a lot, Brother Fulton, Pastor Mallory. You're around, and sometimes you just want to go in and just sit, right? Sometimes, but you know what? Worship is a choice.
That's right.
Pastor Davis reminded that already this morning. Worship is a choice to seek. It's a choice to engage. I've heard people come to church, not necessarily here, but I've heard people say, in fact, I've had people say, hey, we're thinking about leaving our church and maybe moving to another church. What do you think about that, friends? And I'll say, well, why? Why? What led you to that? And I've heard all kinds of reasons. One of those reasons I've heard before is they say, well, we just don't feel fed. We don't feel fed. And I ask them, I almost always ask this question, well, okay, what are you feeding yourself? What are you doing to feed yourself? Because a lot of people come up, kind of like sometimes we do on Sunday dinner when moms or grandma puts the food on the table. We sit down, okay, where's the food? Bring it to me, right? And clean up afterwards. Uh-oh, I'm getting too close to home now. All right, let's move on. Bad illustration, no. Good illustration. Right? Come up to Jesus. All right. Come on. Bless me, Lord. Seek me, Lord.
Amen.
Worship is seeking. And listen, I mean, these are wealthy people. They could have sent somebody to find Jesus. They were packed and ready and looking and made the long, rough journey, not on some beautiful airliner, all right? I mean, these men probably walked when they were too sore riding a camel or whatever it was. By the way, don't ride a camel. They didn't ride camels, all right, back then. Camels are terrible to ride. They're terribly uncomfortable. So they probably walked a lot of this to find Jesus. Because worship is seeking. If our worship doesn't move us to deepen the serious quest of knowing Jesus, then we've missed the star.
That's right.
If your worship never discomforts or inconveniences you, it's probably not worth much. It's not gold or frankincense or myrrh that you're bringing. It's chaff.
That's right.
If you're not seeking with all of your heart. The Star of Bethlehem tells us at least three truths about finding Jesus. First, it tells us that he's come. The Messiah has come. Second, it tells us that he wants to be found. He's put the sign there in the sky that he wants to be found. He's here. He wants to be found. Third, it tells us that he will only be found by seeking him.
That's right. Amen.
It's not merely acknowledging that Jesus is here, so let's worship. The devils know that much. But neither is it enough that Jesus wants to be found. Rather, true worship is a quest. It's seeking. It's seeking Jesus with all of our heart, with all of our mind, with all of our being. We must see Jesus. That's the heart of worship.
That's right.
Now, we may have people that we call worship leaders. And we understand what we mean, people who will lead the singing or do something in the service to direct our worship as we come together. But in reality, every one of us makes a choice, a worship choice. We often emphasize the story of the wise men bringing gifts to a little baby Jesus. And the story is so much bigger than that. At its core, the story is about the great effort that these foreigners made in order to worship the king. They were moved to find Jesus, to offer him gifts. This also tells us that our worship should be Christ-centered.
That's right. Amen.
Our prayer should be Christ-centered. Our singing should be Christ-centered. Our preaching should be Christ-centered. Our testifying should be Christ-centered. Our giving and the offering ought to be Christ-centered. Amen. Now, when was the last time you gave a Christ-centered offering? Amen. When was the last time you put something in the offering and said, I'm so happy to be able to give a gift to my king?
Amen.
Right? More often we think, man, this is going to make this week. I'm going to have to, you know, give up something this week. Just pull out all the stops and give it to King Jesus, right?
Amen.
Second, worship overshadows political allegiance.
Amen.
what we find, what the Magi teach us, is that worship is seeking Jesus, but also that this worship, it overshadows political allegiance, in particular to Herod. Now, I have no doubt that in the coming days, Christians from both sides of the political spectrum will grossly mistake the kingdom of men for the kingdom of God. It happens all the time, right? It's an election year. It's a leap year. Maybe we can just leap over the election. Can we do that? I don't know if we can or not, but... Now, this is not to say that politics don't matter. It's not to say that political issues are amoral or don't have some implication for our faith. They do. But it's very clearly that the Magi were not deterred by Herod or by politics. They certainly weren't intimidated. They weren't intimidated to say that Jesus was their sole focus. They marched right into perhaps the palace, and they asked Herod, the king, the one who's in power, where is Jesus? That's all. That's why we're here. We're here to find Jesus. That's it.
That's good. Right.
They were guided by the star, but there was no starry-eyed wondering for them. In fact, the story shows that the state, represented by Herod, should have followed the wise men's lead. In word, Herod said the right thing. Bring me word that I may too come and worship him. But his heart, his actions were very different. Remember, it's not a person's words that make him a true worshiper of Christ, but it's their actions. Herod said he wanted to worship Christ, but instead he killed Bethlehem's sons. So worship, or what we learn about worship from the Magi, is that worship seeks Jesus. Worship overshadows political allegiance. And third, real worship brings gifts. Brings gifts to Jesus. The wise men made great effort to bring something to Jesus that would symbolize their assurance that Jesus is the true king.
Amen.
Now, did you get that? Jesus is the king. So why wouldn't we bring everything to him?
Amen.
Now, if the occasion were to arise that someone like someone who's a renowned investor, say Warren Buffett, multi-billionaire, right? Made his money investing in land, investing in stock, buying up companies. I mean, just a phenomenal investor, has made billions, right? And if he came to me and if he called me by name, he said, David, just give me everything you have and I will invest it for you. I'd be crazy not to say, sure. You know what you're doing, obviously. Sure, why not? How much more to King Jesus?
Amen.
How much more when God says, give me yourself. Give me what you have. How much more can we trust King Jesus than someone like Warren Buffett or Bill Gates or Herod or anyone else?
Right.
Or much more than even myself? How foolish would it be for us to withhold something from someone who had offered to us to take those gifts and to make them multiply? How much more foolish would it be for us to withhold anything from our Lord and King? The one from whom it comes in the first place, the one who created all in the first place, the one who loves us and has our best interests in his mind far beyond even ourselves or anyone else. Anything we place in his hands is better off.
Right.
No question.
Yeah.
So we learn these lessons, I think important lessons, about worship from the Magi, that worship seeks Jesus. And it doesn't just seek him on Sundays.
That's right.
It doesn't just seek Jesus for an hour on Sunday morning.
That's good.
Worship, for those who are seekers, worship grows until it is our all-encompassing passion.
Amen.
Until it is the drive, the motor that makes us move each and every day.
Amen.
It is the thought that comes to our mind in the mornings when we rise and in the evenings when we prepare to go to bed. Worship that seeks Jesus. Worship that overshadows all of the various cultural, political things that are going on in our world. And we all make various allegiances here and there, interpersonal, you know, relationships, and even in politics. I understand that, but that's so insignificant in relationship to the fact that Jesus alone is King. And I think this year, perhaps we are well reminded to keep this in mind, that in the end, as the prophets have already told us, Isaiah especially, in Isaiah chapters 23 and 24, that the kingdoms of this world will not last. For God is shaking the kingdoms. And in the end, according to Revelation chapter 11, in the end, the kingdoms of this earth will become the kingdom of the Christ. And so while elections come and elections go, someday elections will be over. There will no longer be choice. We're not going to all say, okay, well, let's gather, let's have an election. And if one side wins, then we'll all bow our knees and confess Jesus Christ as Lord. No, there's no election. You understand? There's no election. It will be a benevolent kingship where Christ shares himself with us. And then real worship brings gifts. Real worship doesn't hold back. It seeks until it finds, and it gives. It gives all.
Amen.
It gives all. And so this morning we have a choice. We can look at our own lives and we can say, are there areas of an indifference in my life toward Jesus? Are there things I have reserved for myself that I've kept back from God? I'm not employing what God has given me for the glory of Christ. You know, we give gifts to Jesus when we use what he's given us appropriately for its intended means. When, for instance, when we get our paycheck and we say, okay, God, I want to honor you with my tithe. I want to give 10% of what I've earned. I want to give it back to you because that's what you've asked. That's what God expects.
Amen.
And then God expects me to take care of my family. I'm giving gifts to God when I'm taking care of my home and my family. I'm taking care of the needs of the church, giving even beyond tithes and giving to a Nehemiah project or giving to the school or giving to We Care or those ministries are taking place and affecting our community right here. Those are gifts that we're giving to Jesus.
Right.
We're giving them to Jesus. When we use our time and our energy, when we use what God has blessed us with financially, when we use our relationships and everything that God has given us, when we use it appropriately, it's a gift that we're given to Jesus. And we can do those things in Jesus' name.
That's right.
Not only can we ought to.
Amen.
We ought to.
Amen.
And so, as the song says, wise men still seek him. The good news is, when we seek him, he wants to be found, and he will be found.
Amen.
As we follow that star who for us is the Holy Spirit,
Yes. The
Holy Spirit will always lead us Amen. To Christ.
Amen.
Would you stand with me? Our Father, we thank you that you have given us the gift of your Son, our King, and that you have given to us the guidance of the Holy Spirit to guide our daily steps in walking in holy fellowship with you. I ask now and I pray, dear Lord, that your blessings would be upon this congregation as we go out from this sanctuary and into a new year of our Lord 2020, to be seekers after you with all of our heart, to not be deterred by any of the cultural winds that may blow, and to give to you everything that we have for your glory. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you.